All right, hey guys. So we're gonna be going over lesson six tonight. I'm feeling better than last week, so that's improvement. Yes, you know, the cold just finally went away. So without further ado, let's just get right into it. Should be a relatively short lesson. So, all right. So starting off, we're gonna talk a lot about type one and type two errors. So basically, with every single hypothesis test, there are only two possible outcomes. You either reject or you fail to reject the null. And so we use hypothesis tests. You know, we get like the data from a sample and we use it to inference about the population. But the biggest thing is that we don't know if that inference is correct because there's always a possibility that it will be wrong. So when you're rejecting the null, then, you know, there could definitely be a difference in the population, in which case we made the correct decision by rejecting the null. However, there's also going to be the chance that there's no difference. And so, you know, if we then, you know, reject the null, but there really wasn't a difference, then an error was made and, you know, we messed up. And it's kind of like the opposite with failing to reject the null. If there is no difference in the population, then we made the correct decision by not rejecting the null. But if there is a difference in the population and we missed it, and we still said that we weren't going to reject the null, then an error was made on our part. So basically, the type one error is rejecting the null when the null hypothesis is true. It's really denoted by alpha. It's different from p-value alpha. They're separate things, but people in stat aren't very original. So basically, if p is less than or equal to alpha, then we should reject the null. If p is greater than alpha, then fail to reject the null. And type two error is failing to reject the null hypothesis when the null hypothesis is false, and that's going to be denoted by beta. I'm pretty sure you guys have probably seen this table before. I made it myself, so that's why it doesn't look nearly as pretty as some of the other ones. So basically, I just highly recommend writing this down and memorizing this table. And when it comes time to exam time, just like quickly scribble down the table or something like that, just because it makes it really easy to figure out, you know, like which error is actually going to be, or you can always just remember that if, you know, like the decision was to reject HO when the null hypothesis, when the null hypothesis was true in reality, then you created a type one error. Or if you choose to fail to reject HO when you know, the null hypothesis was actually false, then you created a type two error. So I'll just give you guys like another minute to scribble this down if you need. It's probably one of the more important tables that you guys will see. I will just say that type one and type two errors aren't exactly like the end all be all and like the importance of stat, but you're definitely going to get like at least a question or two about it on your exam. I can almost guarantee it. All right, so this is just kind of like an example, like a real world example. So I'm just going to use the example of, you know, someone's going to trial. So person goes to trial where they're charged for manslaughter. So the null hypothesis would be that they're not guilty, and the alternative hypothesis is that they are guilty. So a type one error would be committed if we reject the null hypothesis when the null hypothesis is true. So basically, what we're saying is, you know, this person did not commit manslaughter, but they're still found guilty anyway. Or, you know, a type two error would be committed if we failed to reject the null hypothesis when the null hypothesis is false. So basically what would be is if the man did actually commit the manslaughter, but was not found guilty. So just trying to help you understand it in any way, shape, or form, you know. Type one, type two. If you still have any questions at the end, just let me know. All right, so selecting an appropriate significance level for when you're doing these like test is very important. So the standard is 0.05. I think that's a very standard level. It's, you know, you guys all probably have it memorized thanks to dealing with p-values and everything. But one of the biggest things is that alpha can be different depending, well, it can really be made different. So basically, the worse the consequences are for committing an error, the lower the alpha should be. And, you know, this is kind of like, it's the same for type 1, type 2. If the consequence is really bad, like going back to the court case example, you know, if making an error means that that person is going to go to jail, you'd want the alpha to be really, really low because you don't want to send a person to jail by accident. But, you know, if it... I'm not going to say, like, you should ever be like, oh, yeah, this thing doesn't matter, so we'll have, like, a really high alpha value. But I'm just saying, like, the worse the consequence, the lower the alpha should be. All right, so there are also some problems when it comes to doing multiple of these tests. So basically, for every time we conduct a test, if we're using the alpha level of 0.05, then we have to accept the fact that there is a 5% chance that we are going to make a type 1 error no matter what. So if you think about this, you know, in another way, if, you know, like, the null is true, then 5 out of every 100 tests would actually be statistically significant due to the type 1 error. So basically what that's saying is 5 out of every 100 tests would say that we should reject the null. And it really just comes down to whether or not we got one of those tests or not, because that could drastically change the, you know, what we do with the outcome. All right, so something else that you guys should know is power. So what that is, it's basically, in the simplest words, the probability of rejecting the null hypothesis correctly. So the way you calculate that is power is 1 minus beta, or it would be 1 minus alpha if you're doing it for type 1, but it's the probability, you know, with beta being the probability of committing a type 2 error. So I just, you know, remember that equation. It's not too difficult. And then where does the value of beta come from? So usually what happens is... yeah, it's kind of like they just assign you a value for beta. It's, you know, the same. It's normally the same of a 0.00. It's a 0.05. So, yeah. Sorry, my window's open. It's getting a little drafty in here. All right. Confidence interval versus hypothesis test. So I tried to just... book was not really clear. Okay. Power. You know, beta is... I'm trying to think of, like, the easiest way to put it. All right, I'm just going to come back to that at the end. Just give me a sec because I don't want to hold much longer. All right, so confidence interval versus hypothesis test. So I just tried to break it down as simply as I could. So for a confidence interval, you're going to be using bootstrapping for your resampling. And so, you know, the graph that you get is going to be centered around the observed sample statistic. Meanwhile, for a hypothesis test, you're going to be using randomization for resampling, so it's going to be centered around the null hypothesis. And those are the two key distinctions for how you're going to tell confidence interval versus hypothesis test apart. Basically, hypothesis test, you're going to have some kind of hypothesis in it where it's saying, oh, we expect it's going to be this. Well, a confidence interval is just going to be like, oh, well, we're trying to find this. So, for instance, if you're trying to find like the population parameter, if you're trying to find like the proportion of just like the proportion.
You will not do this on my final.
You know, if you're just trying to find the proportion of people who do really well on the final, if you hypothesize that it's going to be, if you hypothesize that it's going to be high, then you got to be doing a hypothesis test. If you're just trying to find out what it is, then you're just going to be doing a confidence interval. And so I just wanted to also put this out there that a 95% confidence interval is going to be about equivalent to a two-tailed test with a alpha level of 0.05. So just keep that in mind. It's not like super important, but it's just something that's, you know, nice to have in the back of your head. And I think with that, we're already on the third view. So as I said, it's a pretty short lesson. So the first one, hypothesis test is conducted and the null hypothesis is rejected. Which of the following is a possibility? All right, yep, you guys, it's just gonna be type one error. Congrats. All right, next up. All right, yeah, you guys are on a roll. Also, I did just quickly like write down some thoughts for looking at beta, for like how you'd find beta. They never ask you it. I just quickly wrote it out and I realized like this is really complicated. It's like just a weird like math formula where you have to do a bunch of other stuff. I really wouldn't worry about it. Just, you know, accept whatever beta they give you. You'd never be asked to calculate beta. All right, and then last one. All right. Oh man, you all wish that was your midterm. That would be way too easy. Oh, what the? Okay, that's an issue. All right, so it is C. It's going to be the confidence interval for a mean because it's not asking, it's not giving you any kind of thought up hypothesis. It's not saying, I think the average weight is going to be this, or, you know, for the null and the hypothesized, you know, like the alternative hypothesis would be higher. It's simply just saying, what is the average weight? So you just be using a confidence interval, you just be using all the different weights that you found and just plugging those in with a bootstrap. So. Yeah, with that, that brings us to the end of the review. I don't know why the last slides got cut off. I guess I might have forgot to save before. Anyway, hope y'all had a good night, and I hope, you know, wish you the best of luck in your studying.